How's everybody doing?
Good.
All right, y'all got to do me a huge favor. You know I'm an energy guy, right? So if you love education and you truly believe that education is still the most important part of the American dream, please put your hands together and make some noise. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on. As a matter of fact, I normally save this for the end, right? But I need you to believe, right? Because I believe that education is under attack, right? I believe the educational system is under attack. And I believe that we are the right women and the right men for the job to keep education as a high priority and to change our kids' lives one class at a time. If you believe that, come on, give me some noise. Come on, make some noise. All right, I want you to say with me, I can. Come on, I can. I will. I must. Come on, I can. I will. I must. Come on, now give me some energy. Come on, come on, come on. Yeah, come on, come on. All right, now I need those of you who really believe it, you'll stand on your feet and say with me, I can. Energy, I need to hear outside. I can. Come on, I can. I will. I must. One more time, listen to me very closely. Listen to me very closely. Every school I go to, I keep hearing some teachers talk about the struggle, and I have to continue to tell them, we can, regardless of what's going on. We are professionals. Like, if they need a hero, we are the heroes. And so despite what's going on, we can, we will, and we must. I can. Yep, I can. I will. I must. Come on, I can. I will. I must. Now, energy, come on, come on, come on, come on, come on. Come on, good, good, good. All right, you can be seated. Let me get started. I'm so excited. So for most of you, if you know ET, you know that there was a period in my life where I just woke up one day. She talked about the GED program I taught, talked about the program I did at Michigan State University. And I just remember one day waking up and saying to myself, despite everything that's going on, I got to get to another level, right? And I remember feeling somewhat insufficient, like having this desire to take the educational system to the next level. I had a desire to help kids who had dropped out. Primarily, these were young women who had gotten pregnant, right? And I knew they were gifted, and I knew they were talented. And I knew that they could get in the classroom and do what it took to be successful, right? But they had these barriers, right? And so I just kept thinking to myself, like, I know I can do this. I know I can turn education around. But at that particular time, I must be honest, I had the passion, but I didn't necessarily have the theory. I had the passion, but I didn't necessarily have the effort. And so I remember saying to myself, if I could just find that individual that I could get inspiration from, if I could find that mentor, that person that could give me the blueprint, like I know I can make a difference, like I know I could turn things around. And so I remember going to different people and asking, is there such a person? Does this person exist? Right? And you know how it is, there's this guru. And so everybody kept saying in that particular city, in that particular region, like, this is the person you need to go see. And I remember saying to myself, like, this is it. I've got it. I'm going to meet with this person, and this person is going to change my life. And so I remember our first interaction, right? Our first time we talked to each other. And it was weird because in my mind, like Danielson and The Karate Kid, I had one perspective of what it looked like. Like in my mind, I was thinking, you know, they're going to tell me to read all these books and they're going to give me all this theory and we're going to meet up and they're going to show me these great tools that I could use, and it was different. Right? It was different. I met this individual and that individual inquired, do you really want this? Is this something you really think you can do? And I said, absolutely. I'm ready. Like, I'm ready to go to the next level. I can see kids graduating from my GED program, going to college. I can see it. In my mind's eye, I know exactly what it will look like. And to my surprise, they said to me, all right, Eric, if you're serious, meet me tomorrow morning, 4:30 a.m. at the beach. Now, I'll be honest with you guys. I'm thinking to myself, first of all, 4:30 in the morning is kind of, that's different. That's different. You know, in my mind, I'm thinking, if you are a good mentor, you'll work on my schedule. If you're a good mentor, let's say 11 o'clock in the afternoon. Whatever it is you want to teach, I believe we can still learn that at 11 o'clock. I don't think there's anything magical about 4:30 a.m. As a matter of fact, I'm a little nervous about 4:30 a.m. because there's nobody to hold us accountable. Like, nobody else will be up at 4:30 in the morning. Right? But he had that look in his eye, that sensei look, that if you are serious, then meet me tomorrow, Eric. And I remember saying to myself how empty I felt. On one hand, I felt empowered. I felt that I could do for other youth what someone had done for me. I felt it. I've actually experienced it before. I had a mentor. I had someone when I was homeless. Someone when I was living in abandoned buildings and eating out of trash cans. I had had the experience of someone speaking the right words at the right time, giving me the right support to help me to get my GED and send me off to college. And so I've seen this before. I've been in this movie before. I think now that I'm mature enough that I can do for others what was done for me. And so I said to myself, Eric, as weird as 4:30 a.m. sounds, if 4:30 in the morning is going to do it, then you need to get up at 4:30 in the morning. And so I remember saying to myself, like, okay, you got to go to bed early. Got to have your clothes ready. Like, for 4:30, your clothes are, they have to be ready. Like, everything has to be prepared. Right? And so 4:30, I was at the spot at 4:30. I was at the spot. When I got to the spot, the mentor said to me, let's go out in the water. And so I'm thinking to myself, I'm not really sure. Like, I don't know if you heard the request, right? The request is I sense that I can be an educator. Like, I just feel it. Despite what happened in school, K through 12, let's forget about that, like, right? Let's forget about that and everything I thought a teacher was, right? Let's forget about that. I really feel in my heart that I'm mature now, like, and I feel that it's my calling. I feel a sense of purpose to teach. And so I'm not really sure how going out in the water, I just don't see the connection between the two. If you can help me with the connection. And what I love about the guru is that there are no words. There's only this body language that says, if you want what you say you want, then let's not talk about what you want. Don't question me. I am here to help make your dream become a reality. And so I remember saying to myself, well, it's 4:30 a.m. You're already out here. It wouldn't hurt to start the process. And at any point that you don't feel comfortable, you can come back to shore. Like, I don't know how to swim, but I know how to swim. Like, I grew up in Detroit. I grew up in the city, so we didn't swim, but but occasionally we went to the community rec center, right? And we swam. But I'm very comfortable with 1 foot, 2 feet, 3 feet, like a lifeguard and chlorine, right? This had none of that. I'm like, whoa, I'm not really sure, you know, where we're going. There's no lifeguards out here. But there was something inquisitive. There was something in my spirit that said something about this is right. And I could see myself coming out of that experience and actually making my dream as an educator become a reality. And as I walked out, I remember the water was cold as it hit my feet and then it hit my ankles. And I began to go out a little further and the water hit my knees. And then I began to question myself and say, again, for real, what are you doing? There's nobody out here. It's just you and this guy alone. Like, he could drown you, right? And nobody knows, like, right? But I said, look, you're here, right? So I went a little further, hit my waist, still cold. At this point, I was thinking that, you know, because I had been in the water for a while, that my body would get, you know, acclimated to the water, but it was still cold. And so we went out a little further. He's not saying anything. It's spooky. It's like, it's like the Twilight Zone. And so he's not saying anything, but he has this look on his face, and he's kind of like smiling, and he's excited, he's got me in the water, and then it hits my shoulders. I remember getting to a point saying to myself, like, I don't know. Like, this is too much. Like, the risk factor. Like, for what I'm risking, for what I'm going to get, this is a lot. And I remember him giving me that look, like, look, you're already out here. You've already made such a commitment. And so for those of you in this room, first and foremost, look, I love you. I was an educator 7 years, K through 12, 7 years, Michigan State University. You know, and I heard all this rhetoric about you have people teaching kids that they don't know, they don't understand their experience. I'm like, I get it, but there are those of you who know their experience and you're not in the water. You understand what these kids go through, so you say, but you're not in the water with them. And there are those of you in this room, I love you, I am appreciative for you, especially our females that are in the classroom today, like you are my superhero. People talk about me in my videos, but the reality is you're much more intrusive. You're there every single day. You could have finished school and gone and gotten a degree as a lawyer, an engineer, an astronaut, whatever, and you decided for whatever reason to go into deep waters with these kids. And so I love you, I value you. You are extremely important, and I need you to know that since you are already there and you're with them every day, you're all we have. We don't have, listen, you are there, you're making the commitment, you're already in deep waters. And so what I want to talk about today, since you're already in deep waters, we just need to go the rest of the way. And I remember getting to a point where I was like, nope, I got to turn around. And the guru, it was so funny, as I'm sitting there thinking like, look, Eric, you've made this commitment, you're out here in this water. There are those of you who've been teaching 5 years, 10 years, and some days you come and you say, should I keep doing it? You come some days and say, they're not doing better with the tests. We're doing all of this studying. We're putting in all this work. I don't necessarily see the results. And I just want to encourage you, you're already in deep waters. The water, like, it's up to your... to your shoulders, is already up to your throat. Like, it's already, you're already in it. You're already there. You're past the feet. You're past the ankles. You're past the knees. You're past the waist. You're past the chest. Like, you are immersed in this thing called education. And I want to just do for you what the guru did for me. I just want to push you a little further, right? I want to get you past that 80% that you're loving it, that 90% you're loving it. And just as I was about to turn away, just as I said to myself, like, this is too much. The sacrifice, what I am giving versus what I'm getting, it just doesn't make sense. I need to quit. I need to give up. Like, it just doesn't make sense. It's not that I don't want to do it. I just can't see. And as I began to turn around and walk back to the shore, the guru grabs me by the back of my neck, and he puts me under the water. And I'm like, whoa, okay, this is different. Like, now I went from education to my life, right? And as the guru pushes my head in the water, he takes his leg and puts it around my leg so that I can't move. And he begins to press my head further down the water. And now I, like, literally, like, I'm holding my breath, and 10 seconds go by. 20 seconds go by, and I'm saying to myself in those 20 seconds, like, okay, he's playing. He's going to let me go in a minute. And 30 seconds go by, and he hasn't let me go. And 40 seconds has gone by, and he hasn't let me go. 50 seconds, my life flashes in front of me. And I'm like, I shouldn't have done this. I knew I shouldn't have done this. Like, there was something that said, don't go out in the water. Like, save yourself. 60 seconds, and just when I thought my life was over, boom, he pulls my head out of the water. Oh, man, you're trying to kill me. He said, I didn't try to kill you. What do you mean? I said, you're trying to kill me. I told you I wanted to be an educator. I wanted to go to the next level. Like, I wanted to know the secret to success as it relates to this genre. Like, I just wanted it bad, but I didn't necessarily. He said, young man, I did exactly what I told you I was gonna do. I said, you did not. I don't have any theory. You didn't give me any practice. Like, what was this about? And he said, young man, I need you to answer this question for me. When you were underwater, what were you thinking about? Were you thinking about the basketball game or the football game? Were you thinking about your family? What were you thinking about? And I said, to be honest with you, the only thing I was thinking about was breathing. He said, that's it, young man, that's it. When you go back and you begin this GED program, as you begin this endeavor to be an educator, that's it, that's it. I said, what's it? He said, you just said it. You said when you were underwater, there was only one thing you wanted to do. And what was that? Breathe. I said, breathe. He said, yes, when you want to succeed, as bad as you want to breathe, young man, then you will be successful in any area of your life. And so listen to me very closely. I say this to you. I never said when you want to succeed as bad as you want to eat. Because you can go 21 days, maybe 30, if you're Gandhi or Gandhi's mother without eating. Fast. You can fast for 30 days. I never said when you want to succeed as bad as you want water, because you can go about 3 days or so without it. I said when you want to succeed as bad as you want to breathe, you probably only got a minute or so. Then you'll be successful. And so one of the things I want to do for you as an educator today, you don't necessarily need better skills per se. That's not what you need. But what some of you need is to go from 70% to 120%. Some of you need to go from 80% to 120%. And listen to me, I understand. I just left Florida. I won't say the city or the school. And I did a program all day, and then I did something for parents. Of the 2,500 kids that go to school, only about 50 parents showed up. And some of them were married, so it wasn't even just 50, right? But it didn't bother me because I said to myself, listen to me very closely. The reason why I'm giving 120 is because your daddy's not in your life. The reason why I'm giving 120 is because your father's in prison. The reason why I'm giving 120 is because your mom is working two jobs. The reason why I'm giving 120 is because your grandma is raising you. The reason why I'm giving 120 is because you live in a community where education is not valued. So I don't care what you do academically, when you leave here, you can't go and get credit for getting A's. That in your neighborhood, in your community, nobody affirms you for reading at a certain level. Nobody affirms you for doing well on your ACT or your SAT. Where you come from, education is not affirmed. So even if you are a scholar, you have to keep it to yourself. You have to suppress it. So the reason why I give 120 is because your daddy's not there to give 80, and your mama's too tired to give 100, and your grandma is washed out, so she's giving 50. So I don't just want to be an educator. I don't want to just change the trajectory of their lives. I want to do it as bad as I want to breathe. I don't want to do it as much as I want to eat. I don't want to do it as much as I need to drink. I want to be the best educator in the world as bad as I want to breathe. I want to be the Michael Jordan of education. I want to be the LeBron James of education. I want to be the Gandhi and the Mother Teresa and the Malcolm X and the Martin Luther King and the Coretta Scott King and the Rosa Parks of education. And I ask you the question. I ask you the question today. Are you giving 120? Or are you giving these babies 70 because of what's going on with the state? Or what's going on locally at your school? Or what's going on between you and your principal? Or what's going on between you and your peers? No, listen to me. As we move forward, I must ask you the question, how bad do you want it? How bad? Now I'm gonna ask a question, and I'm gonna ask you to raise your hand, and I need us to be honest here. I need us to be transparent, because we have nothing to prove to anybody. If you're saying, Eric, there was a time where I did want it 120, but as an educator, just being honest with you, I'm a little burnt out. Let me just see your hands. Like, be honest, I'm burnt out. Just be honest, I'm burnt out. Let me see your hands. Let's not, we gotta be transparent. I'm burnt out. Good. So what I need you to do for me, this is important, because if you're burnt out, listen to me, we're the last frontier, guys. We're it. And so we're dealing with real life, and I get that. But we got to want this as bad as we want to breathe, because if we can't get it to them, it's over. They can't get it. And we're not just dealing right now with our local schools and our states, right? we're competing against other countries right now, and not only the let's leave the teachers alone, but because of the lack in some countries, their students want it as bad as they want to breathe. I want to talk about that today. I want to get you first. I want to get you back to 120 because we need you at 120. Like, look, guys, I'm just going to be honest with you. Like, I speak back to that place where not only you love education, but you're coming in with 120%. Because the one thing I know about you, if you are 120%, the outcomes of our babies are going to be totally different. Right? I know that about you. How many of you, and just be honest with me, is you raise your hand and say, Eric, for real, I'm a little burnt out. How many of you can honestly say that being burnt out affects your instruction? Let's be honest. Raise your hand. Good. And we're here not just to get great information. We're here not just to go back, you know, to our schools, right? Our communities with great information. Literally, we're here to go to our schools and take that thing to the next level. And we're counting on you and we need you. But hear what I'm saying first. You matter the most. And I'm here today because I was ignorant 10, 15 years ago. And I put all my energy and effort on students, not realizing that if I change a student, I'm changing one person at a time. If I help teachers, I'm changing 30 kids at a time, times however many classes you teach. All right, so my goal here today is to first get you back up. So look, I need manicures, pedicures. No, I'm serious. Like, we're not here to talk about instruction first. Like, and I'm going to work with John, and we're blessed to work with corporations and different entities that love Eric Thomas and bless. And so I want to find a way to help you. Right, last year we sent through our Delta program, we sent teachers on cruises, sent them to cities for a week, hotels. Right, it's so funny. I had some of my staff members. They're so young and green. You know, they were like, Eric, we're going to bless the teachers. I was like, all right, cool. Wait. They didn't teach. I was like, how do you want to do it? We're going to bless the teachers, and we're going to send them and their students to Disney World. I was like, what about that? Do you think it's good? Like, they're with them all day long. They do not want to go to Disney World. You know, but that's what happens when you've never taught before, right? It sounds great. They're going to go to Disney World. I'll be like, when they get back, they're going to need about a week or two off when they get back. Like, you're not helping anybody, right? So the first thing I want you to do, for real, I need you to take care of yourself. And the way we burn out is that we put everybody else first. And then what happens is the plane is this is teachers, I love us. The plane is crashing, and we're putting the oxygen tank on everybody else. And they're taking it and taking theirs. Like, so they're sucking theirs, and they have yours. And I need you to do me a favor. Number one, when you leave today, I need you to take care of yourself. Right? And I need you to know that if you don't take care of every single thing, some kind of way it'll be taken care of. But if you burn out, we already lost. So I need manicures, pedicures, and I know I got some guys. What about us? I said manicure, pedicure. Listen to me. Like, I was against it at first. I remember my friend, he invited me. I was like, bro, I'm from Detroit. You know what I'm saying? Like, I don't do that, right? He's like, come on, E, come with me. I was like, all right. Then my wife went, and I went. And like after that, I was like once a month, like, yo, sweetheart, do you want a manicure and pedicure? She's like, you're not thinking about me. I'm like, but I am. Right? I need you to take care of yourself. I need vacation by yourself. Look, I need you just to like close your door and don't let kids meet with you in the morning, at lunch, and at night, and your planning session when you're on your way home. Like, I need you to take care of you. Because we are only as good as you are. And so if you're not taking care of you and you're giving me 70% or 80%, I don't have my mom's support, my grandma's support, my dad's dead in jail, I'm being raised by my grandparent, I'm in a single parent home, I'm in a mixed environment, like I'm already going through it at home, and then I come home and the one person I can count on, the one person that gives me attention, the one person that's trying to educate me and change my life, they're coming in burnt out. So I need you to take care of yourself. If you need to, if you're a person in the room and you overextend yourself and you do not take care of yourself in the way you should take care of yourself, come on, if I'm telling the truth, put your hands together and say, Eric, I need, and I want you to say it out loud, I need to do better. Come on, I need to do better. And I need to put the oxygen on myself first. Yep, come on, it's okay. Some of you are hurting, like, no, I can't put it on myself first. Like, that sounds so selfish to you. I can't put it on myself first. I must put it on them. Look, when you're on the airplane, they make it clear, it's gonna come down, the oxygen tank is gonna come down, and they know that there are teachers on the plane. They know you're on the plane. So they have to tell you, they would think it would be common sense, but they have to tell you, whatever you do, don't give it to the person sitting next to you. They have to tell you that. Put it on yourself first, and then help them. I need you to do me a favor. When you go back, and from this point forward in your profession, you're gonna take care of yourself more. If that's you, and you know you need to do it, let me see your hand. You know you need to do it. Good. All right, next year, I'm just gonna see if we can just turn this into a petty manicure station when we come here. All right, I'm gonna work on that next year, all right? So whatever that means for you, read a book, drink a cup of coffee, get some tea, but I just need you to take care of you because you are phenomenal, you're great, but if you're at 70 or 80%, you're no good to us, and we need you. All right, so let's get started. Oh, I'm so sorry, can we pass? I know we got a video, but let's pass that first video. Oh, I've got my own clicker, I love it. They're like, you do it yourself. All right, I love it, I love it, I love it, all right. Good. Can I get some water? Yeah, we good. I need time. I need to know how much time I have. I don't have a timer. Good. So the first thing I want to explain to you guys through school days, what I had to learn as an educator is vertical and horizontal communication. I realized that as an educator, one of the things that we do is that we have so many resources around us and we teach our students to, you know, utilize these resources and we're not utilizing them, right? So one of the things that I started doing was I start going to the schools that I work for and I start talking to other teachers. And they would just tell me little things like, Eric, they're gonna misbehave in the month of March, but it's nothing personal. Their grandma died last year in March, and that was 2 years ago, and it just seems like every March, you know, doing that anniversary is kind of rough on them. Look, guys, vertical and horizontal communication. I started talking to administrators. I started talking to other teachers. I started going to schools. We started to come together as instructors. We start giving each other tips and strategies. What apps are you using? What videos are you using? What are the kids doing? And I learned that I don't have to do it all by myself. You're in the room and you struggle a little bit as an educator, like, yep, I'm so smart, I'm so gifted, that I do find that oftentimes when I'm trying to teach or take my students to another level, I do a lot alone. Let me see your hands. You kind of do it alone. Good. One of the things I want to suggest you do, and I'm telling you in the School Days program, it's so simple. I'm using the colleges in ways that I never used colleges before. These kids have to do so many practicum hours. You know, they have to do so much outside the classroom, and I'm using those programs at Michigan State University. I'm using my social workers. I'm using my educators. They have to put in hours anyway, and I'm allowing them to help me with my programs. I'm bringing in the DJ. I'm using DJs. I'm using music. I'm using videos from the internet that these kids look up to, messages that I hear, you know, on Instagram or memes that I see. I'm bringing all that into my work so that I don't have to do it all alone. All right, now I want to walk you through my journey, and this is why you guys are so important, all right? And here's some of the guys I'm talking about. Number 29, Inky Johnson played for the University of Tennessee, was supposed to be a number 16 draft, got into an accident against Army, almost took his life, right? But he's a motivational speaker. Some of these guys are entertainers, entrepreneurs, and we travel all over the world together. I don't do it alone anymore. And I want to encourage you to not only get information here, but as you're meeting individuals here, let's lighten each other's load, guys. It's going to be so important. All right, so let's get started. So what I wanted to share with you is why you are so important. Now, most of you heard my story, and you know I started homeless at 16. I found out when I was 12, 13 years old, that my father who was raising me wasn't my biological father. My mother married when I was about 5 years old. I knew something was wrong, but I was still young. I didn't know what was wrong, but I knew something was wrong. And so I knew something was wrong because I was one of the only kids in a neighborhood that had three grandmothers. Right, it'll catch up to you. I'll give you some time, right? Now, three grandmas on Christmas is great. Three grandmas' birthday, great, right? But one of these grandmas don't belong, right? And so I never said anything to my mom. Somewhere around 11, 12, I asked my mom, and she said, "You were right, son, that's not your father." She changed my birth certificate, changed my last name, just the whole nine. And so I was so disappointed in my mom. I felt like my whole life was a lie. And so I ran away from home at 12, off and on, and at 16, I left for good. So a lot of times I was in the classrooms and the teachers thought I was a class clown when I really wasn't a class clown, but I was trying to resolve. I was trying to deal with the fact that my mother, who had punished me for lying, that my whole life was a lie, my own mother lied about it, and switched my birth certificate and my whole life to cover this lie. So I brought it to school, and I'm sorry, I'm not saying that was the best thing to do, but I brought it to school, I got counseling, I had private counselors, they put me through programs, and I couldn't deal with the anger of my mom lied. And then what made it so bad, I knew my biological family, I knew my grandma, my uncles, my aunts, I just thought my father, when I would see him, was a friend of the family. So it was so complex that finally at 16, I left home. Ran away from home, of course, left school. And I remember going to church. I didn't grow up in church. I started going to church, and I remember the pastor said to me, "Young man, if you have any dreams, any goals, if you don't want to go to jail, if you don't want to die at an early age, you have to get your GED and go to college." Now listen to me very closely. My grandma had 14 kids. Out of the 14, only three finished high school, and nobody went to college. I grew up in Detroit, Michigan. Culturally, college is not important. Why? It does not make sense to go to college. Whether you finish high school or not, you're only gonna land up at the plant, Ford, GM, or Chrysler. So culturally, I never took school serious. And so this man said to me, when I was probably 17 years old, "Look, every single week, did you get your GED?" And I would say, "No, I didn't get my GED." He'd ask me the next week, "Did you get your GED? As soon as you get your GED, I'm sending you out of Detroit, I'm sending you to college." I said, "Sir, no disrespect, but my family does not do college. My mama barely finished high school. She got pregnant with me her senior year in high school. My grandma didn't go to school. My uncles didn't finish. We don't do school." He said, "I don't care what your family does or does not do. You have a gift. You have an anointing on your life, young man." And let me tell you something. I couldn't spell anointing. And neither did I know what it meant. But listen to me very closely. I want you to understand, as an educator, he did something for me. He gave me an aim that I never had before. My whole life, I remember I was 5 years old and my mom dropped me off at school and I cried. And she said, "When I pick you up, son, I promise you, you're not gonna be crying. You're gonna have so much fun." My mom picked me up that day, I was crying. She picked me up a week later and I was crying. When I dropped out of high school, I'm just going to be honest with you, there was never a day out of the 180 days where I was like, I woke up and was like, "Yes, math, woo, let's go. We got a standardized test, woo, this is what I always dreamed of. Somebody bring me my own personalized number two pencil. Scantron sheet, oh, let's go." I promise you, there was no, I dropped out of high school and I never looked back. But this man said to me, "You have a gift." Dr. Pastor Willis died about 4 months ago of stomach cancer. He was an Army man. Every week he would see me, he would keep pressing me. Listen to me very closely. One of the challenges that I have with school is that we push them and push them and push them and push them, but we don't make the connection between school and their lives. We keep talking about standardized tests. Listen to me very closely. You benefit if they do well. They don't. You talk about grades. They don't see it. Their mom didn't go to school. Their dad didn't go to school. They don't really see the connection. They don't see the value. They don't see the worth. And I'm saying before we teach them how to read, before we teach them geometry, before we teach them trigonometry, before we teach them the eight parts of speech, we have to get them to understand the value. Why do you come here every day? Why are you here? Why do you need to learn? Listen to me. I tell all my kindergartners, no, I'm not playing. One of the challenges I have with the school system is we do all this research, all these statistics, all this data analysis, and we never show the kids. I show my kindergartners, my first graders, my second graders, my third graders, my fourth graders. When I do a presentation, I show them the stats that says, by the third grade, we know if you're going to jail or not. All my kindergartners, first graders, third grade, this is not a joke. They're building prisons right now. And based on your test scores, they know who's coming. So you need to understand, these stats are not for me. I'm 48 years old. These stats say absolutely nothing for me, but these stats say everything about you. If you do not want to go to jail, you better start reading right now. They're gonna talk about why some of you didn't clap when I said that. No, I get it, I get it. I had a Michigan graduate. She was a female teacher in an urban school in the Midwest. And I'll never forget, this is a very poor school and they didn't have books. And I promise you, she would not give them homework. She would make copies of the book and they would do it in class. And I asked her, why aren't you giving them homework? And she began to tell me all the challenges that they have. They don't have money for books. They don't have fathers. Their mothers aren't educated. I said, and that's the exact same reason why they need to be doing homework. That's why you can't let them off the hook. That's why you can't baby them. That's why you can't coddle them. You can't coddle them because they're already behind. The last thing they need to do is take a break. They need to grind because they don't have their mom. They don't have their dad. You need to push them, not coddle them. So first graders, they say you're going to jail if you don't read. First graders, I need you to do me a favor. Pull out the scores and tell me what grade level you are. If you're not on second, third, or fourth, you're in trouble. I bet you when I leave, they're ready to read. And so what my pastor did for me was he gave me an aim. He said, you have an anointing, you have a gift. And every time I get on stage, I think to myself, I was homeless, living in abandoned buildings, eating out of trash cans, coming to church smelling because I didn't have a shower. And he saw this before I saw it. And every day when I would wake up, I never told him, but I would wake up and dream of being what he said I would be one day. Have you ever been to an African-American church? Outside the pastor is a first lady, and the first lady is powerful. And so in 6 months, he put the first lady on me. And he was an army man, so he was very aggressive. Did you get your GED? I'm like, sir, I'm not trying to be funny, but you're not scaring me. My own father not in my life. But when he put his wife on me, she used to give me a hug. She never called me by my name. She called me baby. Baby? I said, yes, ma'am. She said, did you get your GED? I said, no, ma'am. She gave me a kiss. I love you. Go get your GED. He gave me an aim, a personal aim. When they come to school, they don't need our aim, the state's aim, the federal government's aim. They don't need our stat. Look, when they come in, what they need first is, why are you here? What is this going to do for you? And I tell every kid in the urban community, how many of you wish you can move your mama out of the neighborhood she's in right now? How many of you, if you could get your mama a Bentley, how long would it last in your driveway? If you bought a $10,000 television, how long would it last in your home? If you are tired of your mama living in that environment, I need you to kill school. I need you to get a high ACT, a high SAT. I need you to go to Harvard, Yale, Brown, Princeton. I need you to go to school and get a degree so you can come back and move your mom out the hood. I give him a personal aim. And then I love it. He gave me a daily focus. Go get your GED. Hey, look, I can't explain it, but as life would happen, as I start getting serious, a young lady in the church and I start dating. And I'll never forget, I was a year older, dropped out of school, and I remember she came to me. He gave me a daily schedule, a daily task, daily responsibilities. Life had meaning. I remember the young lady from the church came up to me, and she said, I heard you're supposed to be studying for your GED. We had been dating for a while. She said, do you love me? I said, what do you mean, do I love you? She said, no, do you love me? I said, yeah, I love you. She said, I just got my acceptance letter to college. If you don't come with me, I'm breaking up with you. Yep. And she's in the back. We've been married 29 years. Listen to me very closely. I went to night school after the conversation with the pastor, the first lady, and my girlfriend. Once she said, I'm going to college and I'm not going, look, I may be what teachers say dumb, but I ain't stupid. According to the standardized test, I was dumb, but I'm not stupid. I used to watch A Different World. And I knew if I sent that pretty young thing to college for 4 years, 700 miles away, that she wasn't coming back single looking for a high school dropout. And so I went and studied and passed the GED on the first go round. And listen to me. You have to hear me as educators. You got to hear me. Somebody gave education meaning. And the same kid that couldn't stand school now had a reason for graduating. And from that GED, you read the bio, a 4-year degree, a master's degree, and a PhD. Are you hearing what I'm telling you? So listen to me very closely. It's not that I'm dumb and I can't do it. Good. It's not that I'm dumb and can't do it. You know what it was? I never had meaning. And so I need you to do me a favor. When you go back, I need you to give a meaning for being in the classroom. Not school meaning, personal meaning. That this could change your mama's life. This could change your brother's life and your sister's life. This could change the trajectory of your family. And so as I leave, when I got my degree at Michigan State University, my son graduated from Michigan State 2 years ago. My daughter's a senior at Michigan State University. So I'm a high school dropout. My father was a high school dropout. My grandfather was a high school dropout. But because some educator helped change my life and helped me to learn how to read and write and do critical thinking and analysis, reading and comprehension, I was able not only to change my life, but I was able to change the world. So do me a huge favor. How bad do you want it? How bad do you want it? And when you go back, I need you to want it as bad as you want to breathe, because if you want it that bad as a professional, I guarantee you can convince the kids to want it as badly as you want it. I think that's my time. I love you guys so much. Go back. Let's hit it. Again, I can. I will. I must. I can. I will. I must. Come on. I can. I will. I must. Come on. Give me some energy. Thank you.